Welcome everyone to Walking After Whiskey with Trevor and Travis. I'm Trav.
And as always, I'm Trevor.
We're going to break down your latest episode of The Walking Dead tonight.
We're also going to break down a nice bottle of hooch here. Tonight we're drinking Knob Creek.
Right. And what proof is that?
This is 100 proof. It's going to be one hell of a night.
We had a great show for you guys. Like Trevor said, we're going to break down the whiskey for you. We're also going to have an in-depth breakdown of Season 7, Episode 7. Sing me a song.
Sing me a song.
Let's get to the interview, baby.
Indeed. Well, the first thing we see is Michonne doing her roadblock. I don't know what the hell she's doing at first, but she comes down whistling. You know, she's whistling all the dude all day. Not that all the dude all day, but anyway, she's whistling some kind of little melodies. Walkers start following her. Chops up head, and then she sets down her sword and her radio and starts dragging them into the middle of the street. What the hell is she doing?
Was that her radio or was the radio on the zombie? Or
it was her radio.
It was her radio.
Rick has a radio. She has a radio.
Gotcha.
And later on, we see a chick pull up, sees the big old barrier, and then she gets in. I don't know who the hell this chick is yet.
Yeah.
Some red-headed chick. And she said, take me to Negan. I've never seen her before. Maybe you guys have.
Yeah, when I first saw her, I thought she might have been one of the girls we just saw that Tara saw in the Amazonian woman crowd. But then Trevor's like, no, probably not. Because even though they know who Negan is, they might not know where he is. And this girl obviously knew where Negan was.
Maybe she's one of the wives in the hot dresses.
You know what I don't get? Well, no, she would
have. No, she no. Pull that off, though.
Pixie cut, army tank top. That girl's definitely a worker bee. Yeah. And so we go back to seeing.
He's pulling potatoes out of the ground.
We see Carl, back to Carl and Jesus riding into go see Negan in the back of the truck. And Jesus tells Carl, like, what we're going to do is we're going to jump off in sections, we're going to duck and hide, they're not going to see us, right?
In 10 intervals. Show me first.
Jesus, oh my God, he jumps out,
Jesus,
right?
Jesus, exactly.
And right when he pulls the move, and Carl's just like, see ya.
Later.
And he says, I'll see you first. Golly, like, what was I thinking, right?
And for like a comic book word, or scene and word, you see the guys getting into Negan's truck, and Carl has his M16, I believe it is.
Because it looks cool.
I think in the comic book, they killed more guys, like five guys.
14.
Right?
They were like 14 or something. He killed a lot. Da, 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 da.
Okay. In this one, he got one right off the bat. The other one ran out of the track. And Negan comes up. And Negan's like, I ain't gonna lie to you. You were scared the shit out of me. And puts one of the dudes in front of him.
Yeah.
And then two dudes attack him. One of them is Dwight.
Dwight takes him down, right? And then so Carl's out on the ground, no gun. And then, true to form, you know, Negan, being the gentleman that he is, said, here, let me help you up.
No way to treat our new guest.
Yeah, Carl's like, grabbing my hand. He's like, after all that, you're going to grab my hand? You're lucky you got a hand.
Yeah.
And I think as much as he goes off, he's just so charismatic that even Carl's like, okay. Like, it was just like, you can't hate, even though he killed your friends, the guy's nice. Somewhat a nice apocalyptic guy.
Still don't know if he's the bad guy. Everybody hates him, but Rick did kill the guys first, as we said before.
Right. So who's really the bad guy?
And then we're seeing beautiful, beautiful, beautiful Rosita. Mm. Man, she's pretty.
Muy caliente.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So Rosita's back on her kick, you know, asking Eugene to make him a bullet. They had spoken earlier about when Abraham and Eugene were in the milling factory or whatever it is, that he could make bullets. And remember, he gave Rick the instructions on how to make them.
This is this world's new coin, he was saying.
It's the new currency.
Whole magazine is the new coin.
Yeah. So. And so Rosita goes, you told me you'd make me a bullet, now make me a bullet. And Eugene's very reluctant, and she really just lays into him about how much he should be lucky and thankful. He's only there because they all protect him like a little baby. And true to form, he makes sure the bullet for her did not have
a start her sexy revolution, I think is what's going on here. I want to be a part of it.
Tank tops for all.
Yeah.
We go back out. So after everything happens with Carl and Negan, he takes him around his whole warehouse. I think they call it the Saviors. The Saviors call it the Sanctuary, where all the Saviors live. And he's showing him all his harem, where all his women stay, in black dresses, and the comics they have black lingerie. Mm-hmm. And basically shows him how scared everyone is of him, and brings him into his room himself and asks him for a favor for killing his men. He wants something in return. And what did he want in return?
He wants him to sing a song. And as he's singing, "You Are My Sunshine," you see Negan over there practicing swinging his bat. He's like, oh, don't let me interrupt you. Break your concentration.
And he's going after you swinging. So he's like the basic batting practice, which is true to form because he used to be a baseball coach. So it's like really kind of cool to know his backstory and to see him keep emphasizing what he used to be.
And he has the Louisville Slugger, the baddest baseball bat ever made in the world Lucille. For, you know, times like this. And then we see some shit about the rules, mm-hmm. you know, and he goes in and talks to the wives, yeah. sees what's going on. Oh, I heard this, and they don't really want to tell him, so he finds out, and he says, okay.
We see why Dwight got his beautiful birthmark.
Dwight, go start the furnace. And he says, come on, Carl, the Irish should be hot by now.
You know, in the comic books, they never really show how much Negan, like, pokes the bear. Negan's literally poking Dwight's chest every episode you see him, and it almost... He has him as his number two man right now, but he puts so much, you know, a shit pie in his face. It's almost like, how could anybody like you? You know what I mean?
Yeah. But he says, I got a lot of shit to do today. I don't think I could even screw all my wives. He well, says, wait a minute. Maybe I could just screw one wife. And he looks right there at Dwight.
And I want to bring this up because it might be a big deal. But I remember earlier seeing Dwight's girlfriend, even checked by the doctor. First thing that they did was, or last thing they did was give her a pregnancy test. And we all know that that Negan has a soft spot for kids. And when we see this, it kind of makes me wonder, maybe he's trying to get a girl pregnant, which also goes to the whole harem thing and why they're all getting tested. Because later on, when Negan brings Carl back to his place, Negan finds Judith.
Negan finds Judith. They were hanging out at Alexandria like nobody's business. And then I also got to mention, he goes in and sees Olivia again, and she says, you took so much, we're starving. And he goes, looks at her and says, well, if you guys are starving, it looks like that means you're all right.
She starts crying.
Had come with the old fat joke zinger, man. It was pretty funny.
And then he gave her a hug. He's like, you know, I feel bad. I'll take you upstairs right now and lay you down. It'll probably be a lot of fun. And she slaps the stuff out of him, right? And then he goes, I 50% like you better now. Right? Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, and we see a really kind moment with Negan when he grabs Judith.
Like this little angel.
It's not at all apprehensive. He really wants to be a dad, or maybe was a dad. And
I mean, I think you got a call on that one, man. I think you could predict a couple things in the next episode, maybe.
Right, like so later on, we see that you see that the outro. It's like them for the next event of the show. They show Rick looking at Negan with the big like crying face almost, and it almost might be the turning point. Instead of in the show when everyone gets in the comic books when Glenn gets killed, Rick's made his mind up he's going to attack. But right now in the show, he's very much trying to be mute and not trying to attack Negan. But if Negan takes Judith, this is going to be the point in the season as we're going into our
last episode. Make or break, baby. Make or break.
The last episode of the season, this is going to be Rick turning into the Ricktatorship again.
The Ricktatorship. He's got to grow that big old beard back.
So, look, baby, good reviews. Deep in Kentucky, Tiny Knob Creek spills and refills down through the hills. Like the bourbon bearing its name, there's not much of a Knob Creek, but where there is rewards, you find in it. Distilled and bottled and by Knob Creek Distillery in Claremont, Kentucky.
Oh, Knob Creek? That's a man's whiskey. Drink it with steak.
Yes.
Here's the part of the show where we like to get a lot drunker.
Yeah.
It's called the... Three questions.
Three questions.
So here we go. Trav, I'll go first. What time is it when Rick wakes up in the truck with the gay dude?
What time is it? Just past 5:30.
It's 5 a.m.
It's a little past 5:30.
Oh. I'm on the hook for a drink already. So when we see Andrew and Andrew Lincoln looking around at the brush, they're trying to find some kind of crazy weird stash. We come up to this crazy sign that someone has written on the wall warning them to not come forward. The very last sign they see is a huge monologue from this person. Her name is written on the wall. What's her name?
Now we're both drinking.
Leslie William Stanton.
Was it Leslie William Stanton?
Damn!
Yep.
Cheers, baby.
That's good.
This is a nice big tall one. Thanks, Trev.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I approve.
I'll go.
So, in the episode, Rosita and Eugene, after Eugene's made her a bullet, Rosita's just talking down to Eugene, made him feel like a piece of shit this whole entire life of being just a child, a man, baby, and not contributing anything to the group. Rosita tries to tell him sorry for all she said. And Eugene says, no, I'd rather things went back to...
I'd rather things went back to me asking another question.
Yes. You got what you wanted. This is just you feeling bad, not saying that you didn't mean what you said. You meant it, you felt it, that's your truth.
Eugene.
I'd like to take it back to awkward silence now.
Awkward silence.
Yeah, awkward silence. All right, cool, I got it.
You remember that though.
That's where I thought that we might collide in the same little path here. What does Eugene say to Rosita? When he's explaining stuff to her, he says, it doesn't matter if you're...
I've analyzed this top to bottom. It doesn't matter if you're stealthy, snappy, gun, or knifey. Abraham was right. They have the numbers.
White or Mexican?
Stealthy, snipey, gun, or knifey.
Oh, that was a good one. Yeah, yeah, that was a good one.
Yeah.
That was a good line, too.
Yeah, that should cut my...
Thanks, Eugene. Made us a little drink. Go ahead and read the next one.
So I'm going to go ahead and read the next one. All righty. How long was the iron on Mark's face?
Is long enough a good answer?
Long enough is no. We're looking for seconds.
Okay.
Of course we're looking for seconds. I'm asking.
He held it there. He passed out. He peed himself. That has to be at least 9 seconds.
There is a 9 in it. It was 19 seconds.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Melted
no wonder he pissed his pants. I think I pissed my pants too.
He said,
it was 19 seconds, .66. It was like... Just to get tech, I was gonna say that if you got it right. I'm not gonna lie.
Negan is flamboasting and talking with Carl just in his own bedroom, just kind of just getting into Carl's head again. He really likes Carl. He's a very nice man of sorts.
He's a family guy.
Yeah, he just used to be a teacher, gym teacher, and so he's trying to bond with Carl. He likes her. He wants a son. He wished Carl was his kid. He kind of mentors
him.
Give
me the tour.
So. And part of their talk, Negan says this to him. I want you to finish the line for me. You gave me the same stink eye as your dad.
You know, you do the same damn stink eye as your dad, except it's only half as good because, well, you know, you're missing an eye.
But yours just ain't as good because you only got one.
Yours is only half as good. I might take half a drink with you, but good one.
I think that deserves...
Oh, it doesn't matter what you think. You lost.
Half a drink each.
That's our last one?
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll drink that one, gentlemen. We'll drink this shit. One more.
We want to
thank you guys for watching another episode of Walking After Whiskey. Here's a bunch of internet shit and Pedialyte.
Please join our official Walking After Whiskey fan page on Facebook. Also, we're on Instagram at walking_after_whiskey. Please join us, like us, share us, watch our shows. For every join and like and share, we'll put you in for a contest with Funko Pops and t-shirts and all kinds of lollipops and v-shirts.
We're making pencils pretty soon.
Pencils coming to you. Number two, like you can take on your SAT test.
Take a number two, use it in number one.
You're number one. Our fans are always number one.
Yeah, thank you guys. Pedialyte.
Thanks for watching our show. I don't need that much. Love you guys.
Pop the wine bottle and action.
Do you grab that, Trav? Is that what you're doing? Alright, cool. Well, if you kick those of you out of bed, freaking crackers, Maggie, I'd be like, you know, maybe you should eat them in the kitchen.
Oh my god. No, slow. Slow.
No, he's gonna put it in slow-mo.
Oh, okay. But you can go slow too. So it'll be fast.
No.
Alright. Because it'll be normal time. If you go fast and then you put on slow motion, it'll be normal, just normal speed. So if you want to be slow, you gotta do it slow and be super slow.